Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 10th of August 2020. The list of news articles taken up for today's analysis is given here for your reference. Let us now begin our analysis. This editorial talks about the relationship between India and US since India's independence. This editorial will give you a very brief idea about the events surrounding India-US relationship. So let us look at the events now, and we shall also see the recommendations given by the author of this editorial on how to improve India's relationship with US. The relevant syllabus is given here for your reference. First, let us discuss on India-US ties. We can say that from the period 1947 to 1971 was a period of both harmony as well as discord in US-India relations. That is both friendly and unfriendly. First, the author starts this editorial by telling about the support given by US for India's independence. Then in 1950, another event marked the friendship of US and India. It is that the US had plans to remove China as a permanent member at the United Nations Security Council and put India in its place. But if you see, this offer was reportedly refused by the then Prime Minister of India, Jawaharlal Nehru, by telling that India is not going to have the seat at the cost of China. Because if you see, there were some domestic issues happening in China. Then in 1953, during the Cold War, US felt that India was moving more towards Soviet Union and China, especially in the Korean War. So this made US to turn to Pakistan for support. In this regard, the author tells that United States made Pakistan a member of SEATO, that is Southeast Asia Treaty Organization, and also a member of CENTO, that is Central Treaty Organization. And it liberally gave aid and armaments to Pakistan. And Pakistan used all these against India in the subsequent wars with India. Also, it was with US's support that Pakistan could raise the Kashmir issue at the United Nations Security Council. Next, in 1961, the non-alignment movement came into force. If you remember, we have discussed about this non-alignment movement in our 24th July, the Hindu News Analysis. So, by this non-alignment movement coming into force, India formally proclaimed neutrality in the developing Cold War between US and Russia. And this slowly damaged the US-India relations throughout the Cold War. But if you see, still it was not the end of the ties between India and US, because if you see, in 1962, the United States helped India to establish one of the first Indian Institute of Technology, that is IIT at Kanpur. And then if you see, in 1962 Indo-China War, US supported India in the conflict, recognizing McMahon line as the border. So not only in the strategic front and even in the social infrastructure front, US also helped India in terms of agriculture, which resulted in the Green Revolution in India. And we know how this Green Revolution transformed India from a food scarce country to a self-sufficient country within a decade. So you can see that US helped India, but the support of US to India was not consistent throughout this period. Why? Because if you see, 1971 war between India and Pakistan, the United States supported Pakistan. Here, US was not happy with India when India signed a 20-year treaty of friendship and cooperation with the Soviet Union. This is because United States thought that India deviated sharply from its previous position of non-alignment in the Cold War. Also, if you see, by 1970s, US supported China's membership again in the United Nations Security Council, and it also entered into a strategic partnership with China. All this happened when there was a change in the leadership in China, which was favorable for the United States. The author also talks about how China then betrayed India despite India's supports to China by not willing to take that permanent membership in the United Nations Security Council, as we saw earlier. Now, the period from 1974 till 2001 was not favorable for India-US ties. Why? Because we know that in 1974, India detonated its first nuclear device and India became the first nation outside the five permanent members of the United Nations Security Council to have declared nuclear capabilities. So this further pushed US away from India. And if you see, 1978, US ended all nuclear assistance to India when India refused to allow inspections of all its nuclear facilities by the International Atomic Energy Agency. And amidst all these issues between India and US, India faced the worst economic crisis in 1991. At that time, if you see, India forced the United States to recommend the International Monetary Fund, that is IMF, to provide loans for India. And in return, if you see, India gave permission to refuel the United States Air Force planes during the first Gulf War when Iraq occupied Kuwait. Then if you see, in 1998, when India again tested its nuclear devices, US again imposed economic sanctions on India. But shortly in 2000, the then United States President Bill Clinton made the first US presidential trip to India since 1978. And this initiated the phase of friendship between India and US. This trip indicated a shift of US's regional orientation away from Pakistan to India. Now, in 2001, when US lifted the sanctions that was imposed on India after the 1998 nuclear test, it was evident that US was leaning more towards India. And if you see, in 2005, series of agreements like the Energy Security Dialogue, then a new framework for the defense relationship, then the Civil Nuclear Cooperation Initiative were all started. And under the Civil Nuclear Cooperation Initiative, India agreed to separate its civil and military nuclear facilities and place all its civil resources under the safeguards of International Atomic Energy Agency. Then if you see, in 2008, the Nuclear Suppliers Group allowed an exemption to its rules to permit India to engage in nuclear trade for the first time in 3 decades. Then if you see, in 2014, there was an MOU between the Export-Import Bank and an Indian Energy Agency which supported India to develop low-carbon energy alternatives. And this was also like in a way to aid US renewable energy exports to India. Then if you see, in 2016, the United States elevated India to its major defense partner, and there was a series of agreements following this announcement. In 2018, during a 2+2 dialogue between the India and US, the Communications Compatibility and Security Agreement, that is COMCASA, was signed. Then if you see, in 2019, very recently, both sides also signed an industrial security agreement that allows the transfer of defense technology. If you see, this industry security agreement or the industrial security annex is a part of the general security of military information agreement between India and USA. If you see, there are 4 foundational defense agreements which USA usually has with its partners: JSOMIA, then LEMOVA, that is Logistics Exchange Memorandum of Agreement, then COMCASA, that is Communications Compatibility and Security Agreement, and finally BECA, which is the Basic Exchange and Cooperation Agreement for Geospatial Cooperation. Now, India and US has signed the first 3 agreements, and the 4th agreement, BECA, is yet to be signed. So in 2019, this Industrial Security Annex was a part of this JSOMIA agreement. So you can see that at present, the ties between India and US is really good. In this juncture, the author tells that the success of the future bonding between India and US will depend based on the outcome of the US presidential elections that is to happen this November. He tells that the left wing and the liberals in the United States politics are highly critical of Indian government. Why? Because if you see, India's plan to purchase the S-400 air defense missile system from Russia, and also if you see, India refused America's request to send Indian troops to Afghanistan. So all these have angered the United States officials, despite the good relations between India and US. So this is in brief about the history of India-US ties that you can get to know from this editorial. Now let us come to the second part of the editorial, where the author gives the recommendations to improve the present India-US ties. The author tells that India should understand that the relations between India and US require certain give and take on both the sides. So what India requires and what India should give back. The author tells that India needs military equipments from US which US can supply to fight our battles against China on our border. Then if you see, India needs the support of United States and its ally Israel in cyber warfare, and also in satellite mappings of China and Pakistan, and also in hard intelligence on terrorists whom we are fighting at our borders. Also, if you see, India needs technology such as thorium utilization, desalination of seawater, hydrogen fuel cells, etc. So these are some of the requirements of India from United States. Now, what India should give back to United States? The author tells that first, India should help US by sending more troops gradually to Afghanistan and relieve US troops to go home. Because if you see, for a long time, US has been involved in Afghan politics. Secondly, the author tells that India should develop the Andaman and Nicobar and also the Lakshadweep Islands as a naval and air force base with United States support and allow US to share these bases. Thirdly, the author tells that India should also promote bilateral trade. We know that the generic medicine industry is strong in India, and India should make use of this opportunity in its exports. And finally, the author tells that India needs to build trust with the United States such that the give and take will benefit both these sides. But here the author also tells that India needs to be careful on certain fronts. For example, when it comes to the economic relations with US, the author tells that indiscriminate flow of the FDA from US to India should be avoided. And author also cautions that India should not provide the US with our troops to enter Tibet or to be involved in the Hong Kong or the Taiwan issues, because there is always a possibility of a leadership change in China which can be India friendly. It means that the author tells that India should not let US to involve in its bilateral relations with China. So these are some of the precautions discussed by the author. Finally, the author concludes by telling that in the long run, India, US and China should form a trilateral commitment for world peace, provided the current Chinese international policies undergo a healthy change. This is all about the discussion of this editorial. To summarize, we have seen about the history of the relationship between India-US ties since India's independence, and then we saw about the recommendations given by the author to improve the present India-US ties. This discussion will be very much helpful to write answers in your General Studies Paper 2 on questions related to India-US ties or on questions related to the policy of the developed country, that is US, on India's interests. Now have a look at this practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is related to the domestic affairs of the neighboring country of India, which is Sri Lanka. In this analysis, we will see about the recent parliamentary elections in Sri Lanka, then the timeline of Sri Lankan polity from the end of Sri Lankan ethnic conflict till date, and then we shall also see the two important issues related to Tamil population in Sri Lanka. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. See, on 5th of August 2020, that is 5 days back, the Sri Lankan parliamentary elections took place. Know that Sri Lankan parliament is a unicameral body, that is, it has only one house. The strength of the parliament is 225. The members of the parliament are elected by the system of proportional representation. They are elected for a term of 5 years with universal suffrage. Now, the news is that the party led by Mahinda Rajapaksa has secured nearly two-thirds majority in the recent parliamentary election. The name of his party is Sri Lanka Podujana Perumana. If we go through the election results, the party in itself has not secured the two-thirds majority, but along with its coalition, it has secured nearly two-thirds majority. Here, coalition refers to the alliance, nothing but the support of two or more parties to the main party. In case of such support, the new parliament can bring in sweeping changes to the constitution because it has two-thirds majority. Reports are saying that one of the main amendments targeted by the new parliament will be revoking the 19th constitutional amendment. If you see, this amendment was enacted in 2015 by the Sri Lankan parliament. At that time, Ranil Wickremesinghe was the prime minister and Maithripala Sirisena was the president. The 2015 amendment reduced the terms of the president and the parliament from 6 years to 5 years. And it stated that no person who has been elected twice to the office of president shall be qualified again to be elected to the presidential office. So you can understand that why Mahinda Rajapaksa could not become the president again in the present legal setup. This is because he already held the presidential office twice from 2005 till January 2015. So, as a result, till the constitution is amended to his favor, he can only be the prime minister. So, you can see that this 19th constitutional amendment plays a significant role in the present Sri Lankan polity because it curtailed the powers of the president and it distributed the powers more evenly with the prime minister and other democratic institutions. Now, as per news, these developments will be altered by the new parliament. So, this is all about the recent parliamentary elections in Sri Lanka. Now, let us come to the second part of this discussion, which is about the timeline of Sri Lankan polity since the end of Sri Lankan ethnic conflict till date. See, the period from 2006 till the end of May 2009 was the last phase of the ethnic conflict that happened in Sri Lanka. As we know, Mahinda Rajapaksa was president from 2005 till January 2015. Then if you see, Maithripala Sirisena became the president from 2015 till November 2019. And since November 2019, the brother of Mahinda Rajapaksa, who is Gotabaya Rajapaksa, is the current president of Sri Lanka. See, in 2018, there was a brief crisis in Sri Lanka. Why? Because in October 2018, to be specific, the then Sri Lankan president, Maithripala Sirisena, replaced the then Prime Minister, Ranil Wickremesinghe, with Mahinda Rajapaksa as the Prime Minister. However, if you see, Mahinda Rajapaksa failed to form a government that commands a parliamentary majority. So again, Ranil Wickremesinghe resumed office. But if you see, in November 2019, Ranil Wickremesinghe resigned and Mahinda Rajapaksa became the prime minister in the same month. And he was also the member of parliament in Sri Lanka at that time. Now, after winning the elections, Mahinda Rajapaksa has become the prime minister again. Know that during the past, when Mahinda Rajapaksa served as the president, Gotabaya served as the secretary to the Ministry of Defense from November 2005 till January 2015. And it is reported that Gotabaya Rajapaksa was instrumental in ending the 3-decades-long ethnic conflict in Sri Lanka through a skillfully coordinated military strategy. And if you see, the country of Sri Lanka calls this ethnic conflict as terrorism, as per its narrative. Now, there are concerns on issues related to the Tamil population, who are minority in Sri Lanka, and this ethnic conflict was related to this Tamil population. So, let us see the two issues for Tamil people at present in Sri Lanka. The first issue is related to the development and rehabilitation, and the other is devolution of powers as per the 13th Constitutional Amendment. This 13th Amendment to the Sri Lankan Constitution is based on Indo-Sri Lankan Accord of 1987. And the amendment made Tamil as one of the official languages in Sri Lanka. See, some of the key provisions of this amendment have not yet been implemented. In fact, if you see, there is opposition from the top leadership to implement them. Here, the main provision is devolution of land and police powers to the provincial councils in Sri Lanka. If you see, the demand from the side of the Indian government and the Tamil people in Sri Lanka is to implement this devolution provision. So, we have to see how this unfolds in the days to come. So this is all about the discussion of this news article. This analysis would have provided you a crisp idea about the domestic affairs of the country of Sri Lanka, which is one of our neighboring countries. We saw about the recent parliament elections, and then we saw about the timeline of Sri Lankan polity, where the Rajapaksa brothers have played a significant role during the Sri Lankan ethnic conflict till date. And finally, we saw two important issues related to the Tamil population in Sri Lanka. If you see, there are mains questions related to India's neighboring countries. So it is important as an UPSC aspirant to know about the domestic affairs of the neighboring countries in brief, so that you will have an idea about the current affairs that is happening in those countries. Now have a look at this practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article speaks about the conferment of senior advocate status in Supreme Court. In this discussion, we shall discuss the different types of advocates in the higher judiciary, especially the Supreme Court. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. See, broadly, there are 3 types of advocates in the Supreme Court: senior advocates, advocate on record, and other advocates. According to the Advocates Act of 1961, there are 2 types: senior advocates and other advocates. So let us see all these 3 types of advocates. According to this 1961 Advocates Act, an advocate may, with his consent, be designated as a senior advocate if the Supreme Court or a High Court is of the opinion that, by virtue of his ability, he deserves such a distinction. And once designated, the senior advocates shall be subject to such restrictions prescribed by the Bar Council of India. For example, if you see, once an advocate becomes a senior advocate, he or she is not entitled to appear in the Supreme Court without an advocate on record, which means they should always be accompanied by a junior advocate. So who is this advocate on record? See, this category is not mentioned in the Advocates Act of 1961. That's why I told that, as per this act, broadly there are 2 types. In order to get the status of advocate on record, an advocate has to appear and clear the advocate on record examination. And once they become advocate on record, then they can file an appearance or act for a party in the Supreme Court. Thereby, you can understand that these are the people who are eligible to file a petition and practice in the Supreme Court. And the remaining advocates who are registered in any bar council are called as other advocates. And these advocates can appear and argue any matter in the Supreme Court, but if you see, they cannot file any document or matter in the Supreme Court. So know this difference. So from this discussion, you can tell that the advocate on record plays an important role in filing the cases before the Supreme Court. And if you see, they can either work independently or work under a senior advocate. So these are the 3 types of advocates that you need to know. And talking about the conferment of the designation of senior advocate, if you see, in 2018, the Supreme Court came up with guidelines to regulate the conferment of the designation of senior advocates. For this purpose, a permanent committee called Committee for Designation of Senior Advocates was set up. And this committee is chaired by the Chief Justice of India, and this consists of 2 senior most judges of the Supreme Court. Then it also consists of Attorney General and a member of the bar nominated by the above members. And this committee will look into the applications regarding the conferment of the senior advocate designation. And as per the guidelines, this committee is supposed to meet twice in a year to look into the application. But if you see, this committee has met only once after these guidelines came into force. And this is the reason why, in this news article, a senior advocate, Indira Jaisingh, has urged the Supreme Court to brush off its inertia. That is, not to stay idle and start inviting applications from the lawyers for the conferment of senior advocate designation. So this is all about the discussion of this news article. To summarize, we have seen three different types of advocates in Supreme Court: senior advocates, advocate on record, and other advocates. Very rarely you might get a question, but try to know about the different designations that are present in the higher judiciary from knowledge perspective. Now have a look at this practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This question related to the borrowings of the central and the state government has been framed based on this news article, which talks about the increase in borrowings of the state government of Tamil Nadu. The rise in borrowings is due to the fall in the revenue of states due to lockdown and also due to the reduction of GST collections. So the question is, are there any constitutional provisions which enable the center and the states to borrow from the market? The answer is yes. Articles 292 and 293 talk about borrowing of central and state governments respectively. First, let us look at Article 292. As per this article, the central government can borrow either within India or outside India upon the security of the Consolidated Fund of India. The limits of such borrowings will be fixed by the Act of Parliament. Similar to this, Article 293 states that the state governments can borrow within India upon the security of the respective Consolidated Fund of the states. Here you can see that the executive power of a state extends to borrowing only within the territory of India upon the security of the Consolidated Fund of the respective states. And the limits of such borrowings will be fixed by an act of the respective state legislatures. But if you see, when a state wishes to borrow from abroad, that is outside India, then it can be done only upon the security of Consolidated Fund of India. However, if you see, in 2017, the Union Cabinet approved to allow financially sound state governments to borrow directly from the bilateral official development assistance partners for implementation of vital infrastructure projects. So this move will facilitate the state governments to directly borrow from the external bilateral funding agencies, and the concerned state governments will have to furnish guarantee for the loans that they receive. Also, if you see, the Government of India will provide counter guarantee for the loan. Next, if you look at the same Article 293, it says that a state can't raise any loan without the consent of the central government if there is still outstanding part of any loan that has been made to the state by the central government. So these are some of the provisions in Indian Constitution that enable the central and the state governments to borrow from the market. As we already said, due to reduced tax collections and revenue generation, the state governments are borrowing more this year. So this is going to increase the fiscal deficit of the states significantly. We saw many times in the recent past about what is meant by fiscal deficit in simple terms. When the government's non-borrowed receipts fall short of their entire expenditure, then they have to borrow money from the public to meet the shortfall. So this excess of total expenditure over the total non-borrowed receipts is called as fiscal deficit. For example, assume that the government wants to spend 100 rupees this year, but it has only 80 rupees now. So the government borrows 20 rupees from the market, and this borrowing is called the fiscal deficit. See, to arrest the high borrowings and to enforce fiscal discipline, the FRBM Act was enacted. This act mentions certain limits for borrowings for both the central as well as the state governments. The limit for the state governments is 3% of the respective GSDP, that is gross state domestic product. And this limit was raised to 5% by the central government owing to sharp decline in the revenue and tax collections due to the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic. So these are some of the information that you need to know related to the borrowings of the central government as well as the state governments. In particular, we saw about the state governments in this news article discussion. Now with this information, let us look at this question. It is a two-statement question, and you need to choose those statement or statements that are incorrect. The first statement tells that the central government can borrow either within India or outside India upon the security of Consolidated Fund of India. And the second statement tells that a state can raise loan only with the consent of the central government if there is still outstanding any part of loan made to the state by the central government. As we saw during our discussion, both these statements are correct. But read the question carefully. This question demands you to choose those statement or statements which are incorrect. So here the correct answer is option D, neither one nor two. So always in the exam hall, be careful to read the question twice or thrice to know what the question actually demands, whether the correct statements or the incorrect statements. Now let us move on to the next news article. Look at this question about Agriculture Infrastructure Fund, which has been framed based on this news article. See, this news article talks about the new financing scheme of the central government under the Agriculture Infrastructure Fund. The news says that the Prime Minister of India has formally launched the Agriculture Infrastructure Fund and the financing scheme under this fund. This news article also tells that the sixth installment under the PM Kisan scheme was released. In this context, try to know about this Agriculture Infrastructure Fund, which was approved as part of the 20 lakh crore rupee stimulus package announced by the central government in response to the COVID-19 crisis. And you know that PM Kisan is an ongoing scheme of the central government that is implemented since 2018. Now let us discuss about Agriculture Infrastructure Fund. See, it is a pan-India central sector scheme. This scheme will provide a medium to long-term debt financing facility for investment in viable projects. The viable projects include post-harvest management infrastructure and community farming assets. So here the financing will be done through the interest subvention and financial support. Know that the duration for this scheme is from the fiscal year 2020 till the fiscal year 2029 for a period of 10 years. Under this scheme, 1 lakh crore rupees will be provided by banks and financial institutions as loan to the beneficiaries. The list of beneficiaries is given here for your reference. And if you see, the moratorium for repayment under this financing facility may vary, subject to a minimum of 6 months and a maximum of 2 years. Know that all the loans under this financing facility will have an interest subvention of 3% per annum up to a limit of 2 crore rupees. And this subvention will be available for a maximum period of 7 years. Further, if you see, credit guarantee coverage will be available for the eligible borrowers from the scheme under the Credit Guarantee Fund Trust for Micro and Small Enterprises Scheme for loans up to 2 crore rupees. In case of farmer producer organizations who are one of the beneficiaries under the scheme, the credit guarantee may be availed from the facility created under the Farmers Producer Organizations Promotion Scheme. And know that this Farmers Producer Organization Promotion Scheme is under the Department of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. Now coming back to this fund will be managed and monitored through an online management information system platform. Nothing but an MIS platform. It will enable all the qualified entities to apply for loan under this fund. So this is in brief about this Agriculture Infrastructure Fund that you need to know from exam perspective. With this information, let us look at this question about Agriculture Infrastructure Fund. It is a three-statement question and you need to choose those statement or statements which are correct. Look at the first statement. This fund speaks about the aim of the scheme, which is a correct statement. Now look at the second statement. It tells that only primary agricultural credit societies, marketing cooperative societies, farmer producer organizations and self-help groups are eligible to get loans from the fund. This is an incorrect statement. Not just this four, there are a basket of beneficiaries which we saw during our discussion. Now look at the third statement. It tells that it is a centrally sponsored scheme. Just by reading this part, you can tell that the statement is incorrect because we saw that it is a central sector scheme. So the correct answer to this question is option A, one only. Let us move on to the next news article. This question about River Kaveri has been framed based on this news article. This news article mentions about some of the important tributaries and water reservoirs of River Kaveri. And if you see, this question has been inspired from both these previous year UPSC prelims questions, which appeared in the year 2015 and 16. We had question on the tributaries of River Godavari in 2015 and that of Brahmaputra in the year 2016. And it has been quite some time that UPSC has not asked questions about the tributaries. So you can expect a question on tributaries of any river for that sake. So in this context, it is important for you to know about the important tributaries and the important water reservoirs that are located in the Kaveri River basin. Some of the important tributaries of Kaveri River include Kabini, Lakshman Tirtha, Harangi, Swarnavati, and Arkavati, which all join River Kaveri in the state of Karnataka. And if you see, there are three important tributaries that join the Kaveri River in the state of Tamil Nadu, which are Bhavani, Noyyal and Amaravati. So these are some of the major tributaries of River Kaveri. And if you see, some of the major water reservoirs in Kaveri River basin are Hemavati Dam, then Harangi Dam, then Kabini Reservoir, then Krishnarajasagar Reservoir, all of which are located in the state of Karnataka. And we have the Bhavani Sagar Reservoir and Mettur Dam, which is also called as Stanley Reservoir, both of which are located in the state of Tamil Nadu. So these are some of the major reservoirs in Kaveri River Basin. And this map gives you a clear idea about the major tributaries and the water reservoirs that are located in Kaveri River Basin. Try to spot the left bank and the right bank tributaries of Kaveri River Basin by yourself. Now, if you look at this question, it is a straightforward question here. All the three rivers that are mentioned here are tributaries of River Kaveri. The question is, which of the following is are the tributary or tributaries of River Kaveri? Here all three are correct: Kabini, Arkavati and Amaravati. So the correct answer is option D, 1, 2 and 3. Next, let us look at this question on Loya Zirga that has been framed based on this news article which mentions about this term. Here the question is, the term Loya Zirga is sometimes mentioned in the news in the context of the affairs of. The correct answer here is option C, Afghanistan. As you can see in this news article tells that Loya Zirga is basically a traditional Afghan meeting of the tribal elders. They are conducted sometimes in order to decide certain controversial issues. From this news article, you need to know in brief about the domestic affairs of the country of Afghanistan. If you remember, during our 18th May 2020, the Hindu news analysis, we have discussed in detail about the recent domestic affairs of the country of Afghanistan. In that discussion, we saw that on 29th of February, US Taliban peace deal was signed. And as a part of this deal, it was agreed that up to 5,000 Taliban prisoners and up to 1,000 prisoners of Afghan government would be released by 10th of March 2020. But if you see, it did not happen. This issue kept on lingering for some time. And now there is some consensus about this. And Afghan government and the Taliban have decided to hold peace talks after the Afghan government's decision through this 3-day Loya Zirga to release about 400 Taliban militants. So the Afghan government is now hopeful that Taliban will come for peace talks with it. So we request you to watch this 18th May, the Hindu news analysis, to know more about the domestic affairs of the country of Afghanistan. It is also quite important to know from exam perspective, because Afghanistan is crucial for India's relations with Central Asia and beyond, which also includes Russia. So the correct answer for this question is option C, Afghanistan. Now let us look at this news article which mentions about one of the initiatives taken by the state government of Tamil Nadu. See, 3 weeks before, the state government of Tamil Nadu launched its own television channel called as Kalvi TV. In English, it means education channel. It is similar to the Gyan Darshan of Doordarshan TV. Due to the COVID-19 pandemic, all sorts of education, including the school education, is affected. So this is the reason why Tamil Nadu government came up with this Kalvi TV initiative. Now, in order to make this more accessible, the school education department of Tamil Nadu state has decided to telecast lessons in sign language. So the lessons are being prepared for the students of all classes as a part of Veetupalli, which means school at home initiative, in order to ensure remote education to the students of Tamil Nadu. And I hope that many other states might have also come up with such initiatives. Try to mention the initiatives taken by your respective state governments in the comment section. And you can mention such initiatives in your mains answers, especially in your General Studies paper 2 on questions concerned with education sector. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Now let us look at both these news articles, the content and the context of which we have discussed in our yesterday's analysis. This first news article is about ammonium nitrate. And next, if you look at this editorial, it is about the recent air crash that happened at Kozhikode International Airport in the state of Kerala. So we request the viewers to look at yesterday's analysis for both these news articles. And these are self-explanatory. Just try to have a basic understanding about both these news articles. Now let us move on to the practice questions discussion session. Look at this question on United Nations Security Council. It is a two-statement question. The first statement is the non-permanent members are elected for 2-year terms. And the second statement tells that India will be a non-permanent member for the term beginning January 2021. Both the statements are correct. India will be a member from Jan 2021 till the end of 2022. This question asks you to choose the correct statement or statements. Hence, the correct answer is option C, both 1 and 2. Now, look at this question. Three places are given. Arrange the following from south to north. It is a map-based question. The three places are Park Bay, Park Strait, Gulf of Mannar. Here, the correct answer is option B. From south, if you see, Gulf of Mannar. To the north of Gulf of Mannar is Park Bay. And to the north of Park Bay is Park Strait. So, the correct answer is option B, 3, 1, 2. This question is about senior advocates. The question is, the designation of senior advocates to the advocates in Supreme Court is conferred by. Here the correct answer is option D, none of the above. It is based on the Committee for Designation of Senior Advocates. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion and also the practice questions discussion session. If you like the video, press the like button, comment and share, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.